Hello, Captains, and welcome to this Explain 10 video. One of the most frequently asked questions on my channel is what add-ons do you use to make your sim look so realistic? What do you use in terms of aircrafts? What do you think of this particular aircraft? What sceneries do you use? What tools do you use? Can I get your real terahaze settings, and so on and so forth. So what I've decided to do is a 4-series video to basically give you everything that I do on Explain. Part 1, we are going to be covering the basics of Explain, and in part 2 we will look at the payware aircrafts that I use, and that will include both the commercial jets, Boeings, Airbuses, and the like, as well as the general aviation aircrafts like the Cessna and the Pipers. And in part 3, I will take you through a tour of the sceneries that I use and, you know, think that probably are the best sceneries out there. I will be covering some payware and some freeware sceneries as well. And then in part 4, I will basically take you through the different plugins, the tools, and perhaps some of the flight planning software that I use to plan my flights. So, without further ado, let's go ahead and take a look at the basics of Explain. So, first thing first, when you first install Explain, you will probably be in, I don't think it's the Cessna, it's some other aircraft, but the steps that you'll need to take are pretty much the same. The very first thing you'll need to do is you're gonna need to configure your joystick, basically your throttle quadrant and your yoke or your stick to basically respond to the different actions within your aircraft. So what you do is you go to settings, you go to joystick and equipment, and you will get a screen that looks like this without anything here. You will have none, and then all the active or the axis that you'll be able to configure will appear in this color red. So what you need to do, if your configuration is correct, if I say calibrate joystick hardware, as you can see now, everything is set to basically red. So you need to start moving your joystick. So I'm moving my X52 throttle quadrant, and as you can see, now it has turned into green. Okay? And now my throttle quadrant is set. Okay? My speed brakes, there is a kind of a slider on the throttle quadrant. So that is my speed brakes. Okay? And then pitching. Alright, you do up and down, and now the pitch has been set. Roll, so you move your stick or your yoke left and right, and that will set your the roll. And then yaw. Now, this is actually the rudder control. I used to use the SATIC rudder control, and that has given up on me recently. So what I'm doing now is I'm using the rudder control, which is in my X52 stick. So again, you move it left and right until you get the green color, and that means that now that your joystick is configured. So everything is set now. It's pretty simple, and all my equipment is now ready for flight. Okay, now there's another thing that that a lot of people ask me is, how do you program the buttons? And particularly speaking, I have a plugin which is, let me see here, Is it this one here? Or, no. Yeah. You see this METAR query, which you normally see in my videos when I get the Q&H for a particular airport. And the way you do this, instead of going here to plugins and clicking on the NOAA weather plugin and then clicking on the METAR query, we can set a button or a keyboard, whether a joystick button or a keyboard button, to basically get the METAR query. So what you do is you go again to joystick and equipment, and this time you go to bear buttons advanced. Okay, now what you need to do is you need to click on the button that you want to assign. Okay, you need to click here to open the list of plugins that you have. And as you can see, I do have quite a bit of plugins. I'm not sure which one this is. No, that's not the one. There you go. XJPC, and then you'll find the XP NOAA weather. You click on that, and there is the METAR query window toggle. So you click on that, and then you say open. And now, every time you click this joystick button, by the way, I have, I'll show you a picture. A picture will appear now to show you which button is programmed to basically launch the METAR query window. But now this button is set. Okay? So that's how you set up your button to load a particular plugin that you have. Also, another thing that you might want to do is configure some of your keyboards to do certain actions. For example, I have a Control T toggles at a time. A Shift T opens this nearby air traffic controller window, which comes in very handy when you're flying online on VATSIM. So I have Shift and T basically toggles this window on and off. And what you do in order to program a keyboard button, you'll go again to settings, you go to joystick and equipment, but this time you go to keys. And if you scroll down right there, I have, as you can see, I've set up some of these buttons to for world traffic. This one here, Shift T, operation toggle controller window, okay? To assign a button to any action, you click on Add New Key Assignment, and that will show you a button here with no assignment. You click on this button, and now you select any other basically action that you want to associate with this particular button. So, for example, we could say that's a control. Okay, so I'm going to say, for example, Control G. So now, as you can see, this has changed to Control G. And what this is going to do is it's going to, for example, let's see, FMS Direct, Key Save, let's find something good. For example, Replay. And then it's going to replay mode play for movie, okay? Or replay mode off, all right? So once you do that, now this key, once you click on Control G, then this action will basically execute, all right? Okay. All right, so this is pretty much what you need to know to set up your buttons and your, whether keyboard or joystick buttons. It's quite simple, and now you can basically control your aircraft. Now, the X52 is a great stick, in my opinion. It's got a lot of different buttons, so I've got buttons for basically flaps. As you can see, I'm moving this with the button, and then the gear. I've got a button for the gear, for the reverser. I've got a button for the to basically hold the thrust levers at reverse. And you can basically play with this now. All right. So you're done with your joystick. Now let's go a little bit and look at data and input output. Now this is a very useful, basically useful screen. And what you can do in this here is show, for example, your frame rate, show the sim stats, show the times, speeds, atmospheric weather, aircraft, system pressures. You can show a lot of engine power, RPM, any data that is associated with the X-plane world can be displayed. So if I click on display frame rate, for example, and let's remove this, as you can see now, this is my frame rate, CPU utilization, GPU utilization. So that's how you basically configure this little screen here to give you some useful information about your sim. Operations and warnings. Okay, this is a very important part which allows you to basically start aircrafts in a cold and dark state or with the engines running on the runway. Language, of course, you can select your language here. This particular here says flight models per frame. What I've noticed with this is with some aircrafts, not all, for example, with the Airfoils Lab Cessna 172, when I'm on the ground, I kind of, when you look down at the ground, you see that the ground is shaking and sometimes increasing or decreasing this number will get rid of that for you. Now, don't quote me on this. I've seen it happen to some aircrafts, but not others. It has helped me with the Airfoils Lab Cessna. I think I've increased the number to 3, and the shaking ground stops completely. You need to play with this a little bit. Be careful, though, because increasing this number can lower your frame rates. So be careful there. Okay, startup. This is basically where you say, I want to start every flight on the ramp, which will basically put your flight at the gate. Start each flight in cold and dark, meaning that basically the engines will be off. So the aircraft will be completely in cold and dark state. Okay. Now, this particular feature here, which is cold and dark, some aircraft, some of the airplanes have a feature to actually start with the engines running. So it will override this this setting here for that particular aircraft. Okay. All right. So damage. This one basically is your realism settings, if you will. I pretty much I've left this at default. Reset on hard crash. Remove flying surfaces in over G. I haven't. That's not ticked. I think maybe it will add a little bit more fun if you add these, but then you have to be very careful while flying. So this is kind of your realism settings, and let me tell you, those work. I've tried this and they work pretty well. Okay, warnings, again, this is self-explanatory. It can basically warn you of incomplete scenery installations. Mainly, this will happen if, for example, you install a custom scenery into your custom scenery folder and then some of the libraries are missing or maybe there is a corrupt file, so you will get a warning. Warn of low frame rate, you can have that if you like. Require warning confirmation, I have both of these ticked off. Automatically notify of updates, this is a useful feature. When there is an update by X-plane, then you'll get a notification. Show ADC taxi instruction arrows. What this is, if you're using X-plane ATC, basically once you request taxi or when you're ready for taxi, basically the arrows, there will be arrows on the ground leading you to the runway. So that is on. I actually never use the built-in ATC with an X-plane. I think it's pretty bad. But I've left this at default. All right. Now it says here, this is I think this is a it's a good thing to keep this ticked. Send usage data to laminar research. You know, it's as it's your choice really. I keep it on. I think they use this data to improve the application, to improve our simming experience, so why not? Alright? Okay. Now, one of the other top asked questions on my channel is how do you install scenery? Yeah, that's one of the frequently asked questions. So, to install scenery, what I'm going to do now is I am going to say render options, and then I will go to frame node. Okay, so you download the files from the org store, and you simply go to your explain folder into custom scenery, and you just dump the file there. If there are any additional instructions that are required for that particular scenery file that you've downloaded, you'll need to read the README file, and it will tell you if any additional steps are required to make your scenery work. But I would say the majority of custom scenery packages will simply just be a simple cut, copy, paste into your custom scenery folder. Now, maybe you're wondering, what is this custom scenery inactive folder that I have here? And what I've noticed is when you have everything in custom scenery, actually, if you look here at your... let's go to custom scenery, all right? And if you go to the scenery packs that I, okay, these are all the different packages that I have, okay? Different scenery files, and they're quite a bit, yeah? But what I've noticed is that when you fly over an area that has, let's say that you're flying in Germany, and then you fly over Munich, and then you go to Frankfurt, and you're, while in the air, these airports will be loaded, okay? So for one, if you have everything in the custom scenery folder, it will load those airports or sceneries as you pass by them or you fly by them. They will be loaded, and that might actually hinder performance. Okay. The other thing I also noticed is that when you're starting up Explain or you're moving from one airport to another airport here, select global airport, okay, these files actually get loaded by Explain. So it fetches all of these custom sceneries, which will basically cause the sim to take quite a bit of time to load all these sceneries. So what I do normally is in the inactive custom scenery, inactive, this is, by the way, this folder I created, I put in the airports that I don't use, so that, you know, I reduce the you know, the load time. Normally when I'm flying over, I keep everything in custom scenery, but when I'm, for example, let's say I want to do a video over in Germany, then I go and remove all the airports that are in Germany in that vicinity, okay, and I only keep two airports, which is the from and to airports in the custom custom scenery folder, and that way it will save you a lot of time, load time, as well as performance. Your performance will not be basically hit as much as if you went if you were to, you know, have all your airports, especially have a lot of airports, then it will really, your the performance will really take a hit. All right. So enough of that, and now we've covered basically everything here except the rendering options. We'll leave that for now. Plugins, this is where you go to basically launch your plugins, okay? Special, there is a quite a bit of things here that you can go and play with. Show sky colors, projector setup, weapon guidance, bouncers, you know, you can fiddle around with these. Environment. Now, in environment, The weather system, this is something that you'll see that says set weather uniformly for the whole world, okay? But that's actually not the case for me because I'm using NOAA weather plugin. And NOAA weather plugin basically sets this automatically. So even if I actually try to click something else, it won't allow me to do it because NOAA weather plugin takes care of the weather for me. And it sets everything here based on the real data that it receives. But this is an area where you can go and play with explain and say, okay, I want precipitation to be high. You can play with the wind speed, wind gust. You can do all kinds of different things if you want to, for example, practice, you know, crosswind landings and what have you. This is where you come to set your exact weather situation. And I think this is a great feature in explain. And it ships out of the box. It's an amazing, really, feature in explain. Okay, and then of course, date and time. You can basically always track date and time. That means that it will track the real date and time. That's what it says. So if you click this and the time is night, it's basically going to be night time in your sim. And it's going to follow your system clock, so you can adjust the GMT hours here. If you have daylight savings and things like that, so you can play with that there. Okay, so that is now done. Okay, location up. Location has this, of course, select global airport is where you select the global airport. And if you want to practice your landings, the best way to do it is to simply select 10 nautical miles or 3 nautical miles. This is going to put the aircraft on a path to the runway that is either 10 or 3 nautical miles away. And this way you can practice your landing without having to actually, you know, start the aircraft, take off, make a turn. This will basically help you put the plane just right at the runway, lined up with the runway for landing. And that way, maybe you can, you might want to practice, you know, crosswind landing and things like that. So that's something that you can do there. But even more interestingly, there is a feature here in the local map, and the local map is something that I really like about explain because it gives you a lot of information about your flight. You've got, of course, the high speed local map, you've got the low en route local map, then you've got the high, and you've got the sectional as well. Look at that. Not just that, you also have a textured map, right? So this is something that I really, really like about explain. It gives you a lot of information while you're flying. You can select it to show clouds, precipitation, NDB, VORs, DMEs, ILS runways on the map, which is I think is really a great feature. You can also show instruments if you like here, if you click there, instruments. So you can actually, while you're flying, maybe, you know, you want to watch the path, but you also want to watch your speed, you want to watch your altitude, your vertical speed, and your heading. So basically you can track all of this information right here from your map. Okay? The slope is something that I've explained in one of my videos. It was in back, I think it's a 6 month old or maybe more video where I showed you how you can basically edit the ILS heading when it is not basically aligned with the runway. So I'm not going to cover that in this video. But this is where you go to edit it, basically. You can load up situations, you can reset the path, you can shut down, you can, again, you can put to the takeoff or the final approach 3 and 10 nautical miles. Yet even better than this, yeah, you can actually set the current altitude, okay, here. So I say I want my plane to be at 5,000 feet, and I want the speed to be, 100 knots. You can specify the climb angle, whether it's a carrier heading or a frigate heading, all right? And then you can just say, take me there. And as you can see now, it's actually loading, and it will put the plane exactly at those, you see this? Now we are actually flying at the information, the same information that we've specified, and now it has positioned the plane exactly in that location at exactly the altitude that we have selected. And this is again a, I think this is a great feature of X-Plane. It's marvelous, really, because it allows you to practice all kinds of approaches, and it saves you a lot of time. Instead of flying, for example, the entire flight plan, you can simply place your aircraft wherever you like, and there you go. Okay, alright, so let's go ahead and just go back to the airport, and now we're set there. Let me set this to so we can see. Alright, okay, very well. Alright, so we've covered this. There's, of course, the planet map, okay, which you can see where the plane is, and you can select a different location to take your aircraft to, simply from within the globe. And here, let's see where we have positioned ourselves. Somewhere here. It looks like it's raining here. All right. And of course, this is where you can take a screenshot, shift in space, you can load up toggle AVI movie, the movie specs. I actually never used this. I use Shadowplay to record all my videos. And you have a logbook, okay, so you can actually look at the different flights that you've taken, and you can create a different pilot logbook here. Alright. So, we have covered pretty much everything that is important. There is also this feature, by the way, when you see me in some of my videos where I do an instant replay of the landing, this is basically what I use. I use toggle replay mode, okay? And that can take you back in time. Basically, and then you can hit just play, and then it will simply play it will do an instant replay of your flight. It's a nice feature, and you can do also slow motion. So if you can go here and click that, that will be slow motion. Okay. So yeah, it's raining here. This is very weird in X-Plane, but okay. All right. So that is done. And there is one more thing that I want to cover before we conclude on this video, which is something that really annoys me quite a bit. If you have the DVD version of X-Plane, then every now and then it will tell you, please insert DVD number 1 so that it can read this and verify that you have explained. Now what I'm gonna show you is something probably you shouldn't be doing, but I've done it because I got really upset with having to bring the DVD, put the DVD in, and sometimes I kind of have to take the DVD out and have to put it back again because it's random. It asks you for the DVD at random. So let me show you what I've done. By the way, this is Shadowplay, which I used to record. But what I've done is I've created, you see this here, I've created an ISO image of the DVD so that I can access it directly without having to insert the DVD. So my DVD tray is now empty. Okay, I have no DVD in my DVD tray. And as you can see here, this here is an ISO image, or ISO image. It's a disk image file that I've created of the DVD number 1. Okay, once you do that, the only thing that you have to do is, if you shut down your PC and turn it back on, you need just to simply go in and double click that, and then it will automatically put this DVD drive F explain 10. So this is now an equivalent to the DVD number 1. It works fine, guys. I love it. The loading of Xplane is much, much faster now because it doesn't have to, of course, read from the hard drive. So this is basically what I think there is a program called Magic ISO, which you can use to create an image of your DVD. And that's pretty much what I wanted to cover in part 1 of the guide to Xplane 10. In part 2, we will be looking at the different aircrafts, payware, and we're just going to be looking at payware, but we're going to be looking at commercial as well as general aviation aircrafts in part 2 of this guide to Xplane 10. Folks, I hope that this has been a useful video for you, and until next time, please take care of yourselves and each other. Bye-bye for now.